I found this script a really long time ago. I don't actually remember how long ago, called Tonight He Comes. It was an original screenplay by Vincent No. This was kind of a famously unproduced script. Really great, dark, nihilistic story. It was a very postmodern riff on Superman.
Kiva asked me if I was interested in this movie about a superhero who was kind of alienated and showed me a screenplay by Vincent No. And I fell in love with the idea of it. And so Akiva and I started developing it together as something for me to direct.
Akiva Goldsman mentioned the idea that Michael Mann was working on a superhero movie. And I was like, what is the Michael Mann version of a superhero? And I got the script, and it was just a dead serious, straightforward look at what it would be like to be a superhero.
I started actually imagining that I'm on stages shooting green screen and blue screen and all the visual effects, and I know that as a director, I really react to real reality and real locations, and I really kind of feed off of that. And I said, you know what, I'm the wrong guy to be directing this, so then Akiva and I decided we would produce it together.
The script was sent to Will and I, and a really unique, interesting character, really unique, interesting way to do a superhero movie.
While we were making I Am Legend, Michael said, guys, I've got the director.
Actor one, cock in, action!
I thought Pete was great casting for this because he has an intuitive sense of energy and has and can be very improvisational in his choices.
Let me see some pain now.
It had everything to do with how special this film turned out to be. Because of his originality.
I was certain that I wanted him to do this picture.
Anytime you can have someone who is firing on all cylinders the way that Pete is, can't help but be a perfect addition to a team.
Seemed like in success, it could be really original. And then because Will Smith was attached, that certainly made it more appealing.
Back!
That'll do it.
Will explores everything many different ways at the same time.
Will Smith's got his head right all the time. He's got a saying, you know, he says, if you stay ready, you never have to get ready. And there's, I think, truth to that. He's fearless, he's talented, and he's extremely honest. And those three elements come together and create a situation where he can play almost anything, and he's certainly willing to try.
Part of what lies beneath that talent is a real generosity of spirit. There's a goodness, a kindness. There's like real fundamental compassion, which you can't fake. That's not acting, that's truth.
Will Smith is famous. People love him.
Because I don't know if you've heard of him, but he's a pretty big star. He could chop the head off a cat and everyone would be like, that Will.
Hey. Good to see you, man.
Well, such a skilled comedian.
Hey, and all you people up there blocking the intersection, good job. Good job.
There's a certain kind of aggressive humor. And then the only guy on the planet who can pull that off, and you love him for it all the time, you know, is Will Smith.
What, you want a cookie? Down on my face.
As far as, you know, being a real jerk.
What?
You heard me?
And then at the same time being so incredibly endearing, which he is so good at doing, finding that kind of vulnerability.
Dear Hancock, that's my favorite one, and I want you to have it.
Will played it so beautifully, and his chemistry with Jason Bateman and the character that Jason plays is brilliant, is really, really brilliant, and the two of them complement each other so incredibly well.
Good job. Good job. Good job.
The guy is just like the greatest guy I've ever worked with, and I've worked with some pretty nice people.
Charlize is fearless like Will.
And also deeply, deeply funny, which people don't know.
She tried to kill me just now.
We just had a ball, and you know, she fit right in with the wanting to have fun, wanting to keep the energy up and playful.
Charlize is equally kind, equally talented. a little bit better looking than Will. You know, he's running a tight second.
In addition to obviously being beautiful, she's a real actress and really committed and willing to do anything and try anything and smart and complicated.
I like to travel. I'm allergic to cats. I'm immortal.
Just save all of that. Looking good, Bateman.
And then Jason Bateman, I was in the middle of working with him and I was reading the script and he walked by one day and said, what are you reading? And I said, Tonight He Comes. He's like, I'm doing that movie. And I'm like, maybe I'm doing that movie too.
And I said, is that right?
He's like, all right, we're doing that movie together. And I said, okay.
And so we didn't talk about it for a while. And then on rap day, when everyone says, you know, hey, nice to work with you, and hug, kiss, goodbye, he whispered in my ear that there might be a good chance that we're doing it together. So that was a very exciting goodbye. And then a month or so later, I heard from him, and here I am. Lucky boy.
Come here, we're gonna do great out there, and we're gonna fix everything. Do you know what I mean?
I know what you mean, Ray.
Jason's the total package, and you need that. Just as a guy in the audience, you're thinking, I would want to be friends with him. So you understand why Hancock would.
I mean, he's genius. I think he's next as far as a leading man. Just his comedy, emotion, he's the truth.
The three of them provided real quality acting for real drama and emotion. This felt like I was working with the absolute top of the top. I really was excited about the opportunity to try and create a new superhero.
Fundamentally, this is a construct that was given birth to by Vincent Ngo and then raised by Vincent Gilligan.
I had experience with Vince Gilligan from television, and then we got Vince involved. And we started enlarging the frame of it.
Life here can be difficult for me. After all, I'm the only one of my kind.
The mission for me, as described to me by Akiva Goldsman and Michael Mann, was to make the character and the story a little more accessible, if you will.
You deserve better from me. I can be better. I will be better.
All right. It's such a unique, bizarre, wonderful concept. What's great about being able to do it with a superhero is you can tell the story with mythological proportions, but the patterns and the ideas of the story fit over everyday life.
You save people's lives, and they reject you, and so you reject them back.
It's a vicious cycle, and we're gonna break it. We're gonna start afresh. That's fantastic.
All of those doors kind of open to us, and then start to feel like we have something that has a mythic backstory that we can make in a really nice way, kind of ordinary, in the present.
And when you look at Hancock, who has totally separated himself from humanity and from the world and from people, that idea that there is only misery in that kind of separation.
What kind of bastard must I have been that nobody was there to claim me?
The mythological idea of the story is that we all have purpose. And if you're not living the purpose that you have, that there's only going to be misery.
You have a calling, you're a hero, Hancock. You're gonna be miserable the rest of your life until you accept that.
Well, what is a superhero? Is it just this thing that we just accept? We just go, oh, well, they're superheroes.
There's certain kind of mythic figures that are in our culture that perpetuate, they're universal. In the human experience.
There were these super beings that we came to know as gods.
Gods, angels, different cultures call us by different names. Now all of a sudden it's superhero.
But they were these immortal beings who had powers far beyond us and yet who had the same weaknesses and anger issues and depression that we all have.
Hancock's tragically and painfully abandoned and has been drinking himself into this state that he is in when we first find him.
There's this deep hurt underneath, and he really understands that he has to kind of address that hurt.
People get to choose.
And you chose to let me think I was here alone.
Turns out that he is not the last of his kind. They are the last two of their kind. What he doesn't remember is their endless push me, pull you of a relationship that has gone on for eons.
Whatever I did, look at me.
I'm sorry.
What causes that, you know, the mutual attraction and mutual movement apart from each other that inevitably has always happened and it's been going on for years?
I'm gonna do this all day.
Boom. The oppositional force was the relationship. So we had to imbue the relationship with a dynamic that could stop Hancock.
They can't connect with each other, because if they connect with each other physically and emotionally, they lose their powers. And that's why Hancock is our last superhero. He never did that with another god.
You have to leave. You'll start getting your powers back and saving people before you know it.
The tragedy in this story is that he does love her, but he also is driven to save lives and to protect humanity, and he needs to be a superhero to do it. First and foremost, it's about relationships and how hard they are to maintain.
All those years, not knowing who I was, looking for something.
Hancock's missing some huge part of his life, a big hole. And it was Mary.
So that's you. I guess that's what you're saying. You're what I was looking for.
And the tragedy is that when he's with Mary, when he spends enough time with Mary, that bond creates this issue of them losing their powers. The powers sort of ebb away, which she wants more than anything.
Or living forever isn't all that it's cracked up to be. There's some unreal attributes to being part of the process of all other organic life on the planet and joining in that.
See the good in everybody, Ray.
She's kind of relaxed over the millennia. I think she's come to realize over the many, many years that helping a few select people makes about as much sense as helping the masses.
I thought it was really flawed and interesting, and I thought the story really kind of lent itself for us to have the opportunity to explore everything about the human condition.